Blackstone Publishing presents Kate Wilhelm in Orbit by Kate Wilhelm. This book is read by Richard Powers, Carrington MacDuffie, Hilary Huber, Patrick Lawlor, and Adam Verner.
Orbit 1, Starus Flanderans, read by Richard Powers.
The great ship had picked up an uneven coating of space debris. Her once silver sides were scabrous with the detritus of ancient collisions and explosions. Planetary, stellar, galactic rubble that had been hurtled out from high-velocity impacts, or from even more furious paroxysms of novas and supernovas, to hurtle through space until the minute gravitational field of the ship netted speeding dust motes and drew them to her sides. A gaping rent on one side of her, and many dents and scars, told of blind passage through the littered reaches. The ship was spinning erratically, not on her own axis to give interior gravity, but with a lopsided, over-her-left-shoulder tumble. There was still enough silver left for her to reflect some of the starlight when the patrol boat first sighted her visually. She had been a blip on the scanner a long time before. She was close enough to view on the screen. The three men watching her were silent while she tumbled twice. They were satisfied she was the dead ship they were after. A luxury liner had first spotted her. The captain had made no attempt to board, but had plotted her course and filed a report. "She's right on schedule," Conley said. His voice was harsh and abrupt. He was big, more than 6 feet tall, 200 pounds or more, with bold features. A too large nose, square thrusting chin, ears that stood away from his shaved head, a high, heavy forehead, and wide gray eyes that gave him a false look of feline cruelty. He was in command of the fleet scout craft. As Conley turned from the screen, Malco, the second man watching, whistled softly between his teeth. Shorter than Conley, he was more massive, with a great heavily muscled chest, bulging biceps and leg muscles, spatulate fingers. His legs, arms, and chest were covered with black curly hair. He had a curling beard and heavy black eyebrows. His eyes were dark blue. There were many crinkle lines of laughter on his face, about his eyes. The third man was not a human. He was Stain, the Chlaysan observer. He also turned from the screen and watched Conley take his place before the controls. Stain was much shorter than either of his companions, although if he chose, he could elongate himself to their height. Stain drew his mantle closer about his body and flowed toward his own couch. He was shaped like an inverted tulip when he gathered his mantle about him. The mantle looked like dark gray leather. Under it, his body parts were soft and pink. His brain was encased in more leathery covering, as were his tentacles. His eyes were close to his body now, but they could extend. The eyeballs had transparent protectors over them. His upper half served as a sense organ, like an ear, with inner parts, complex mazes of tubes, membranes, chambers. The organ allowed him to feel vibrations well above and below the human range of hearing. Stain knew his human companions were considered handsome among their own kind. He was beautiful in the eyes of his people. When he got to his couch, he flowed up onto it, then let himself settle down to a slightly raised mound of leather. He sealed the mantle. "Ready?" Conley asked. They would accelerate to approach the derelict, lock onto her, and investigate from her stem to her stern. Malco grunted, and Stain said, "Let's go." Under his mantle was a two-way radio that had been modified so that it amplified his chest vibrations and translated them into sounds that were intelligible to the humans. Conley brought the small scout closer to the great ship, matching her speed until they were side by side. The slow tumble of the crippled ship caused her to wobble as she turned over.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.